Now come to our next point, linear combination of vectors and linear span of a set. See what is linear combination. Definition is, suppose we have a vector space and we have n vectors, alpha 1, alpha 2, so on, alpha n in V. Then any vector alpha, which is written as a1 alpha 1 plus a2 alpha 2 plus so on, plus an alpha n, where a1, a2, so on, an belongs to F, is called a linear combination of the vectors alpha 1, alpha 2, so on, alpha n. It means the vector alpha is written as a linear combination of the vectors alpha 1 to alpha n of V. So this representation of vector is called a linear combination of the vectors. Next, see the linear span. Suppose we have a vector space VF and S be any non-empty subset of V, then the linear span of S is the set. Linear span of S is the set of all linear combinations of finite sets. See here, the finite set should be finite of elements of S. The sets are made by the elements of S and it is denoted by LS. It means we will write LS as LS is equal to the set containing elements of the type A1 alpha 1 plus A2 alpha 2 plus 1 plus AN alpha N, such that alpha 1 alpha 2 so on alpha N, it is any arbitrary finite subset of S. And A1 to AN, this is any finite, arbitrary finite subset of F. So linear span will be represented by this. So it will contain all linear combinations. So keep this in your mind. Now there is a theorem. The linear span LS of any subset S of a vector space VF is a subspace of V generated by S. It means LS is equal to S. So suppose we have a vector space V and a subset S of the vector space S, then find, prepare a linear span LS, means the set of all linear combinations. So we need to prove that this LS is equal to S, or this is a subspace of V generated by S. See its proof. Suppose let alpha beta be any two elements of LS. Suppose we take two elements alpha beta in S, then alpha can be written as a linear combination of alpha 1 to alpha m, and beta can be written as a linear combination of beta 1 to beta n. So alpha is equal to a1 alpha 1 plus a2 alpha 2 plus 1 plus am alpha n, and beta is equal to b1 beta 1 plus b2 beta 2 plus 1 plus bn beta n. Here a is, and b is, means a1 a2 so on am, and b1 a2 so on bm bn, they are elements of F, and alphas and betas, they are elements of S. Alphas means alpha 1 to alpha 2 alpha m, and beta 1 beta 2 so on beta n, they are elements of S. Now, if we have two elements AB of the set F or the field F, then A alpha plus B beta can be written as A into representation of alpha is A1 alpha 1 plus A2 alpha 2 plus 1 plus AM alpha M plus B into BN beta 1 plus B2 beta 2 plus 1 plus BN beta N. It can be written A1 alpha 1 plus A2 alpha 2 plus 1 plus AM alpha M plus B BN beta 1 plus B2 beta 2 plus 1 plus B BN beta N. Again, it can be written as A1 alpha 1 plus A2 alpha 2 plus 1 plus AM alpha M plus BBN beta 1 plus BB2 beta 2 plus 1 plus BBN beta N. Now see AM, A2, so on AM, and BB1, BB2, so on BBN, they are all elements of F. Since F is a field, so AA1 will also be in F. Thus A alpha plus B beta, it has been expressed as a linear combination of a finite set alpha 1 to alpha M, beta 1 to beta N, means M plus N elements of the elements of F. Consequently, A alpha plus B beta, it will belong to LS. Next, thus AB belongs to F and alpha beta belongs to LS implies A alpha plus beta belongs to LS. Hence, from the earlier theorem, LS will be a subspace of VF. Also, each element of S belongs to LS, because if X alpha R belongs to S, then alpha R can be written as 1 into alpha R. It is a linear combination and this implies that alpha R belongs to LS. Thus, this LS is a subspace of V and S is contained in LS. Now, if W is any subspace of V containing S, then each element of LS must be in W, since W is to be closed under vector addition and scalar multiplication. So, LS will be contained in W. Therefore, LS is equal to S. It means LS is the smallest subspace of V containing S. See, there are two points also. Suppose S is a non-empty subset of a vector space V, then a vector alpha and V will be in the subspace of V generated by S if it can be expressed as a linear combination over F of a finite number of vectors. It is very clear. Next, there are some examples. Let us see them one by one. See this example one. The subset containing a single element 100 of the vector space V3F generates a subspace which is the totality of the elements of the form A00. Since A00 can be written as A into 100, so it is clear that this element will generate the subspace containing the elements of the form A00. Second, the subset 100010 of V3F generates a subspace which is the totality of the elements of the form AB0. Since AB0 can be written as A into 100 plus B into 010. So this set will generate this subset of V3F generate the subspace containing the elements of the type AB0. Third example, see the subset S equal to 100010001 of V3F. It generates, or you can say spans, the entire vector space V3F. Since it is V3F, it has the elements of the type ABC. So ABC can be written as A into 100 plus B into 010 plus C into 001. So LS is equal to FC here. If ABC be any element of V, then ABC can be written as A into 100 plus B into 010 plus C into 001. It means ABC belongs to LS, hence V is a subset of LS. Also, LS is a subset of V, hence LS is equal to V. So, similarly, you can see example 4. Let V be the vector space of all polynomials over the field F. Let S be the subset of V, consist of the polynomials F0, F1, F2, so on, Fn, defined by Fn is equal to S to the power n, then V will be LS. See here, one more definition, linear sum of two subspaces. Suppose W1, W2 be two subspaces of the vector space VF, then the linear sum of W1, W2 will be denoted by W1 plus W2. It will be the set written as W1 plus W2, it is equal to or alpha1 plus alpha2, such that alpha1 is in W1 and alpha2 is in W2. Now, you have two theorems based on the linear sum of two subspaces. The first is W1 plus W2, it will also be a subspace of VF. And second, W1 plus W2 will be W1 union W2. I don't think it is part of your syllabus. So let us skip this one and move on to our next topic. So our next topic is linear dependence and linear independence of vectors. See the definition of linear dependence. Let VF be a vector space. A finite set alpha1, alpha2, so on, alpha n of vectors of V is said to be linearly dependent if there exist scalars a1, a2, so on, an in F, not all of them zero, such that a1 alpha 1 plus a2 alpha 2 plus 1 plus an alpha n is equal to 0. If this relation holds true, or you can say linear combination of the vectors alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha n is equal to 0, but the coefficients a1, a2, a3, so on, an, not all of them are 0, then this set will be called linearly dependent. Next, linear independence. For a vector space VF, a finite set alpha 1, alpha 2, so on, alpha n will be called linearly independent if we have a1 alpha 1 plus a2 alpha 2 plus 1 plus an alpha n is equal to 0. It implies that ai is equal to 0, means all the coefficients are 0. If all the coefficients are 0, then it will be linearly independent. If some of the coefficients are non-zero, or you can say at least one coefficient is non-zero, then it will be linearly dependent. So this is the basic difference between linear independent vectors and linearly dependent vectors. Keep this in your mind. An infinite set of vectors of V is said to be linearly independent if its every finite subset is linearly independent. Suppose we have an infinite set of vectors V, and we want to say it linearly independent, then every finite subset of it should be linearly independent. Otherwise, we will call it as linearly dependent. In a very hurry, we can solve one example. See, prove that if two vectors are linearly dependent, one of them is a scalar multiple of the other. It's very important. Suppose we have two linearly dependent vectors alpha 1, alpha and beta. Then there exists AB, not both of them zero, such that AB, A alpha plus beta will be zero. It is clear from the definition of linear dependence that it is zero, but not all coefficients are zero. So A alpha plus beta is equal to zero. If A is non-zero, then we can write A alpha is equal to minus B beta, or alpha can be written as minus B by A beta. It means alpha is a scalar multiple of beta. Since A is non-zero, so we can divide it. So alpha is a scalar multiple of beta. A scalar multiple is minus B by A. So this is our proof. Next, second, if B is non-zero, then we can add B beta is equal to minus alpha. So beta can be written as minus A by B and into alpha. Again, since B is non-zero, so this is our scalar multiple. So it means beta is a scalar multiple of alpha. So it is also true. Again, thus one of the vectors alpha and beta is a scalar multiple of the other. So it is proved. Now, I think it is sufficient for today's class. If you have any query or any